ओम परतत्वे सदा लीनो राम कृष्ण समाज्ञया यो धर्म स्थापन रतो वीरेशं तं नमाम्यहम्। कंप्लीटेड रीडिंग थ्री पार्ट्स ऑफ स्वामी विवेकानंद प्रैक्टिकल वेदांत एंड टुडे वी हैव टू रीड द फोर्थ पार्ट एंड लेट अस रिमेंबर व्हाट वी हैव रीड अप टिल नाउ। In the first part, Swamiji told, Vedanta is practical. It has been practiced first and theorized afterwards. And he showed that the busiest people could realize and practice Vedanta. And he defined the practice of Vedanta in three phases. To draw as many implications as possible from the Vedantic truths, which could be applied in our daily life today. That would prepare our mind. And the second phase, though he was studying or reading the Chandogya Upanishad, he brought in from Brihadaranyaka, which is accepted throughout the Vedanta, the only path of sadhana, and that is Shravan Manan Nididhyasana, and that would lead to the realization of Vedantic truth. So that is the second phase of practical Vedanta. Vedanta to be practiced. And the third phase is the life of the man of realization. This is described in the first part. In the second part, he told certain stories from the Chandogya Upanishad, and made us understand that this is the Advaita Vedanta, which is very practical, and then this has to be realized, not only talked about. And that was the main thrust in the second lecture, that good and bad are relative in this world. But those who go beyond, that path is different. And yet, in the beginning of the second chapter, he had told that the things of daily use were taken up to represent Brahman, and that way it was made practical. In the third part, we saw mainly the stories from Chandogya Upanishad, and Swamiji telling that there are two principles of knowledge. One is that the particular has to be referred to general, general to universal. And second principle is that explanation of everything should come from within. And he showed that when you apply this to religion, we find that it is only the Advaita Vedanta which satisfies these conditions fully. He explained there that though reason is not the final authority, but reason can disprove the things which are wrong. And final authority will be only experienced through the heart. But that final thing has to be rational. Reason should be satisfied that this thing is not irrational. And that is satisfied by Vedanta only. That was the seventh substance. And now we come to the fourth part of practical Vedanta. Practical Vedanta part 4, delivered in London, 18th November 1896. As I told you, a series of lectures on Chandogya Upanishad. Even before these four lectures, there was one on the 5th November, which is a part of Jnana Yoga now, which you are going to read after this book. We have been dealing more with the universal so far, because therein is the only reality. The reality cannot be an individual. Reality cannot have parts even. So the individuals are only appearances, reflections at the most of the consciousness. And so the reality has been universal, and so we have been dealing more with the universal so far. This morning I shall try to place before you the Vedantic ideas of the relation of the particular to the universal. Particular means what we call the jivas. And because that is the appearance which we feel and see today. So how we are connected to the universal, how universal is the real and we are only appearances, also has to be shown. Then the Vedanta will become complete. In Sri Ramakrishna's language, this is what he describes as the ripe I. If I, as an individual, is so-and-so's son, so-and-so's father, then that is in relation to my body. That is unripe I. But if my connection is with God, any connection, but my definition is from God, I am God's son, friend, part, whatever you may say, then that is the beginning of spiritual life according to Sri Ramakrishna. And that will gradually lead us to full identification with God. So that relation is important and that is being discussed today. As we have seen in the dualistic form of Vedic doctrines, remember, not Vedantika, that means in the Karma Kanda portion of the Vedas. The earlier forms, yes, Karma Kanda comes earlier. There was a clearly defined particular and limited soul for every being. Then only the going to heaven, doing karma and all that is possible if there is an individual self. And that was as described in the Karma Kanda. There have been a great many theories about this particular soul in each individual. There have been theories. In the third chapter, we had another discussion between realism and idealism and between substance and qualities, and we were shown that the Buddhists say that you experience only qualities. Why assume the substance? And the Advaita Vedanta satisfies by telling, we realize the substance and we call it not the substance with qualities, but we call it the reality. And so, qualities are appearances only. Both cannot be experienced together. So that again comes up. Many theories about this individual soul, as everybody conceives. Nobody has seen the individual soul. Those who have seen the individual soul, they know that there is no individual soul. It is universal only. It is all our inferential or within our mind ideas only about the individual soul. And therefore, there are many. So many minds, so many ideas. But the main discussion was between the ancient Vedantist and the ancient Buddhist. Ancient Vedantist, Samaji means the dualist, the qualified monist, these are the ancient Vedantists. The beginning, the crude forms of Vedanta. And there, they suppose that there is an individual soul and these are his characteristics. Within them, there were differences. But Swamiji says all of them belong to one party who think that there is an individual soul. And the other party is Buddhist who deny the presence of an individual soul. So that is the main discussion. The former believing in the individual soul as complete in itself, the latter denying in toto the existence of such an individual soul. As I told you the other day, it is pretty much the same discussion you have in Europe as to substance and quality. One set holding that behind the qualities there is something as substance in which the qualities inhere, and the other denying the existence of such a substance as being unnecessary. The qualities we experience, so we need not assume a substance. For the qualities may live by themselves. We experience them, that's all. The most ancient theory of the soul, of course, is based upon the argument of self-identity. Now, he's explaining the basis on which this those who believe in individual soul, they base their theories. So, the first point he takes, which is obvious, because even the common man thinks like that, I am I. That the I of yesterday is the I of today. That is the common belief. We are not analyzed whether the I of yesterday is the I of today. But that is our feeling and common feeling. And that I of today will be the I of tomorrow. That in spite of all the changes that are happening into the body, I yet believe that I am the same I. So if I am the body, body changing, yet I believe that I am a self. That is, only the idea in the mind, almost baseless. This seems to have been the central argument with those who believed in a limited and yet perfectly complete individual soul. On the other hand, the ancient Buddhists denied the necessity of such an assumption. They said this is an assumption and there is no need to assume like this. They brought forward the argument that all that we know and all that we possibly can know are simply the changes. What we experience, changes. What is continuity? Continuity of changes. That is what Buddhists think. And their analysis is very sharp, much sharper than any argument of the dualist Vedantist. But their experience is sharp. The positing of an unchangeable and unchanging substance is simply superfluous. And even if there were any such unchangeable thing, we could never understand it. Nor should we ever be able to cognize it in any sense of the word. Understand by buddhi, cognize by any indriya, or by our bodha, in any sense we cannot cognize. We are continuously engaged with qualities. Except for shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha, we are not experiencing anything. All our theories, ideas, whether it is physical sciences or whether it is philosophies of dualism, the same discussion you will find at the present time. Swamiji is explaining this in England. So the English people are conversant with the discussion going on in England. So this is Swamiji's way, through the known to the unknown, by describing the discussion in England, Swamiji throwing light upon the discussion in India. The same discussion you will find at the present time going on in Europe between the religionists and the idealists. On the one side, religionists means Christians. They believe in a soul. Idealists means those who believe that inside something is there. And the modern positivists and agnostics on the other. Positivist means they believe in the experience only. And agnostics means believing in the experience, we find that we do not know the reality. We do not know the reality is the conclusion. So the agnostics and the positivists, they believe only in our present experience. And if the experience is incomplete, we do not know anything. And the religionists believe in a soul. The idealists believe that everything is within. One said, believing there is something which does not change, of whom the latest representative is your Herbert Spencer. You know a story about Swami Vivekananda? When he was a young student of the college, he was much influenced by Spencer and Mill. And while reading Spencer's book, he found an error of argument. Following Spencer's line of thought, there was an error. And he wrote a letter to Herbert Spencer. And Herbert Spencer accepted, yes, this has been my error, I will correct it in the next edition. So Swamiji was thorough with the ideas of Miller and Spencer. Mill and Spencer. That we catch a glimpse of something which is unchangeable. And the other is represented by the modern Comteist. Comte is the philosopher. So following him is the Comteist, they are the positivists. We experience the thing. And modern agnostics, there he has not given the name, but the agnostics believe that we cannot know. Kant is a big agnostic, that we cannot know the reality of anything. Those of you who were interested a few years ago in the discussion between Herbert Spencer and Frederick Harrison, Harrison is the representative, agnostic. Might have noticed that it was the same old difficulty. The one party standing for a substance being the changeful, and the other party denying the necessity for such an assumption. One party says we cannot conceive of changes without conceiving of something which does not change. But that is our concept only, not fact. The other party brings out the argument that this is superfluous. We can only conceive of something which is changing. And as to the unchanging, we can neither know, feel or sense it. No feel or sense. So in any way we are not able to comprehend the unchangeable. Those who have not been able to comprehend. And the Advaita Vedanta will show that is the truth. That can be comprehended. That can be thought of. That can be realized. So that is what Swamiji is leading us to through these two schools. In India, this great question did not find its solution in very ancient times, neither in Karmakanda nor in the dualistic theory. Because we have seen that the assumption of a substance which is behind the qualities and which is not the qualities can never be substantiated, can never be substantiated. So we cannot find a solution. Nay, even the argument from self-identity, from memory, that I am the same I, that Swamiji brings again now. There he had mentioned it, and now he is bringing to discuss it. That I am the I of yesterday because I remember it. So why I am the I of yesterday? Do I see the changes in the body? Because I remember it. And therefore, I have been a continuous something, cannot be substantiated. Now to think about this. This Swamiji has not yet analyzed, he has not yet stated. And the one more theory is bringing, the other quibble that is generally put forward is a mere delusion of words. Quibble means apparent argument. For instance, a man may take a long series of such sentences as, I do, I go, I dream, I sleep, I move, and here, that means continuity, that continuity is past, present and future, this continuity is within present, different actions and thoughts. And here you will find it claimed that the doing, going, dreaming, etc. have been changing, but what remained constant was that I. Apparently, as such, they conclude that the I is something which is constant and the individual in itself, but all the changes belong to the body. This, though apparently very convincing and clear, is based upon the mere play on words. Word fallacy. This is a logical fallacy. The I and the doing, going and dreaming may be separate in black and white, but no one can separate them in his mind. That is the Buddhistic argument. They say you go, then you eat. You were defined as going, that person which was going. Now that is not there. Now you are defined as eating. So you are now the person who is eating. That going person has gone. So if we are sharp, unattached to our body and thinking, we can find this analysis. Otherwise, without thinking much, we feel, I am same. So Swamiji is now analyzing this quibble and finding that it is not true. No one can separate them in his mind. But I am, I'll tell you grammatically, You say, I am a good boy. So, what is I? Good boy. I am eating. So, what I am eating? This is not a play of words. Verb is used as a verb and also as a gerund. So, sun is shining. Not that sun is sometimes not shining. Sun means shining. So, I am eating means I is defined by eat. What is I? Eating. I am eating. I am playing. So I am playing. I am eating. How can playing be eating? Swamiji is explaining this. When I eat, I think of myself as eating. I am identified with eating. When I run, I and the running are not two separate things. Thus, the argument from personal identity does not seem to be very strong. The other argument from memory, so now I bring back the memory argument. First, in the present tense itself, the continuity is through words only, not real. Now, through the memory. The other argument from memory is also weak. How? Swamiji is showing how beautiful here. If the identity of my being is represented by my memory, many things which I have forgotten are lost from that identity. I do not remember everything. So I did not do those things. If memory is the proof of my existence, then no memory is the proof that I did not exist. And we know that people under certain conditions forget their whole past. Some accident or something happened, they forget their whole past. In many cases of lunacy, a man will think of himself as made of glass or as being an animal. If the existence of that man depends upon memory, he has become glass, which not being the case, we cannot make the identity of the self depend on such a flimsy substance as memory. So, many cases memory is not there, many cases memory is wrong, objectively we can see that, and so the argument from memory does not stand. Thus we see that the soul as a limited yet complete and continuing identity cannot be established as separate from the qualities. So what I am, Shabda Sparsha Rupa Rasa Gandha, or fatness, leanness, blindness, these are my qualities. We cannot establish a narrowed down, limited existence to which is attached a bunch of qualities. On the other hand, the argument of the ancient Buddhist seems to be stronger, that we do not know and cannot know anything that is beyond the bunch of qualities. In the worldly sense, only when we evolve, when we consciousness is developed, then we can know. So without realizing, this talking of a continuous soul is of no meaning. And as I said, if we can actually see ourselves, we will find we are universal. There is no individual at all. Nobody has seen his individual soul. What we are seeing, qualities. And if we are able to see our real nature, we will find it is universal only. There is no shred of I left there. According to them, the soul consists of a bundle of qualities called sensations and feelings. That's all. What is over in the mind? A mass of such is what is called the soul. And this mass is continuously changing. Our qualities are continuously changing. The total of these qualities is what we are. Pungal. Then they change. The Advaitist theory of the soul reconciles both these positions. Reconciles is the word Swamiji has used. It does not deny both, it explains both. So it reconciles. It says that, oh, your assumption is correct. He tells the Buddhists that we experience only qualities is correct. But we can experience the reality and then these qualities will not exist. That explains both of your positions. You are looking at this side, they are looking at that side. The position of the Advaitis is that it is true that we cannot think of the substance as separate from the qualities. We cannot think of change and non-change at the same time. It would be impossible. But the very thing which is the substance is the quality. We are seeing the qualities. If we develop our consciousness, we shall see the reality. Substance and quality are not two things. It is the unchangeable, that is appearing as the changeable. So changes are appearances. If we can stop the change in our mind, we can perceive the unchangeable. And then there will be no changes. Changes are only in the mind. The unchangeable substance of the universe is not something separate from it in the universe. The phenomenon is not something different from the phenomena. So here we jump upon the Advaita and the Dvaita appearance. This continuous thing cannot be individual, because individual is qualities only. As soon as we transcend the qualities, we will find the self which is universal. That is the problem. But it is the very phenomenon which has become the phenomena. Become is crude language, so you will go on refining it. There is a soul which is unchanging. And what that we call feelings and perceptions, nay, even the body, are the very soul seen from another point of view. So when we are in what we call today's consciousness, we are very much lower than the truth. And there we see the body. We have got into the habit of thinking that we have bodies and souls and so forth. But really speaking, there is only one. Did the philosophers have created the delusion, or our mind conceives that we have a soul? We know we have a body, we conceive we have a soul. But one reality, when the according to the development of consciousness, appears as the body, as the prana, as the mind, as the I consciousness, as the reality, according to the evolved or developed state of consciousness. So the whole thing again comes back to the evolution of consciousness. When I think of myself as the body, I am only the what? Only a body. It is meaningless to say I am something else. And when I think of myself as the soul, the body vanishes. Think means experience. And the perception of the body does not remain. Then only the soul is perceived. Then the perception of body does not remain. None can get the perception of the self without his perception of the body having vanished. Very important, very important. Liar, Vedanta again and again says. Unless this consciousness of body vanishes, we cannot perceive the soul. None can get perception of the substance without his perception of the qualities being vanished, having vanished. Transcendent. The ancient illustration of Advaita, of the rope being taken for a snake, second time it has come, may elucidate the point a little more. And the reason is difficult to explain, but example can explain. When a man mistakes the rope for a snake, the rope has vanished. And when he takes it for a rope, the snake has vanished, and the rope only remains. The ideas of dual or trivial existence come from reasoning on insufficient data. And we read them in books or hear about them. That's all. Philosophers have created it. Until we come under the delusion that we really have a dual perception of the soul and the body. But such a perception never really exists. Perception of body and soul. The perception is either of the body or of the soul. It requires no arguments to prove it. You can verify it in your own mind. Just from, if you analyze our own experience, we find it. No arguments. Try to think of yourself as a soul, as a disembodied something. You will find it to be almost impossible. And those few who are able to do so will find that at the time when they realize them, think you are stealing. Almost impossible is stealing. And now it will realize, actual experience. And those few who are able to do so will find that at the time when they realize themselves as a soul, they have no idea of the body. You have heard of or perhaps have seen persons who on particular occasions had been in peculiar states of mind. Bhava, Swamiji is explaining bhavana, brought about by deep meditation. Self-hypnotism, hysteria or drugs. Through different means, the consciousness can appear to change. Really it changes only by meditation. But these are the different things. In America it had become too much popular, LSD and all that. In India, Ganja is famous for that. Meditation, self-hypnotism, that means you can yourself tell your mind that you are something else and you will start believing that you are that. Hysteria is madness, temporary, or drugs. As I told you, LSD or other drugs are there. From their experience, you may gather that when they were perceiving the internal something, the external had vanished for them. So Swamiji is going through the mundane experiences, because samadhi or jnana everybody does not have, but this will indicate the possibility. This shows that whatever exists is one. That one is appearing in these various forms, and all these various forms give rise to the relation of cause and effect. Various forms, that means body, mind, etc., is like cause and effect is telling. The relation of cause and effect is one of evolution. The one becomes the other, and so on. So, evolution means the same thing appears as something new. That's all. That is the cause and effect. It cannot change. The relation of cause and effect is one of evolution. The one becomes the other, and so on. Sometimes the cause vanishes, as it were, and in its place lives the effect. If the soul is the cause of the body, the soul, as it were, vanishes for the time being and the body remains. And when the body vanishes, the soul remains. This theory fits the argument of the Buddhists that were leveled against the assumption of the dualism of body and soul by denying the duality and showing that the substance and the qualities are one and the same thing appearing in various forms. So that is only through change of consciousness, realizing, then only we can talk of Vedanta. That is practical Vedanta. You have seen also that this idea of the unchangeable can be established only so regard the whole. So, this individual itself vanishes. If this body vanishes, if this mind vanishes, the soul can never be separated from the universal. But never as regard the part. The very idea of part comes from the idea of change or motion. Yes. Everything that is limited we can understand and know because it is changeable. And the whole must be unchangeable because there is no other thing besides it in relation to which change would be possible. So as I told you, this part and whole is only a language. Samaji is being the individual and the universal. Change is always in regard to something which does not change or which changes relatively less. Yes, in perception we can find this. According to Advaita, therefore, the idea of the soul as universal, unchangeable and immortal can be demonstrated as far as possible. Demonstrated means rationally explained, and reason cannot reach it, so as far as possible. The difficulty would be as regards the particular. What shall we do with the old dualistic theories which have such a hold upon us and which we are all to pass through? It is there, so we have to pass through. These beliefs in limited little individual souls. So it is impossible to define an individual soul. But we have that. We have seen that we are immortal with regard to the whole. But the difficulty is, we desire so much to be immortal as parts of the whole. And then we have devised so many theories. That is because of our desire. Even the desire shoots up from the reality, from the fact, from the truth that we are whole. But that is not clearly seen. But the idea remains. So, as an individual, we want to be one. We have seen that we are infinite and that is our real individuality. But we want so much to make these little souls individual. What becomes of them when we find in our everyday experience that these little souls are individuals with only this reservation that they are continuously growing individuals? So, Swamiji is now analyzing our today experience. We think we are individuals, but we are growing individuals. They are the same, yet not the same. That is what we think. The I of yesterday is the I of today, yet not so. It is changed somewhat. Now by getting rid of the dualistic conceptions, that in the midst of all the changes, there is something that does not change, and taking the most modern of conceptions, that of evolution, we find that the I is a continuously changing, expanding entity. So he is now trying to explain. This is the position of the Vishishta Advaita, qualified non-dualism, that we are growing every day. If it be true that man is the evolution of, now Swamiji is explaining through science. If it be true that man is the evolution of a mollusk, that Swamiji told, amoeba, mollusk, protoplasm, the smallest life. The mollusk individual is the same as the man, only it has been expanded a great deal. So, evolution means expansion. It is not yet expressed. Manifestation is a better word. But we are thinking of expansion. Okay. From mollusk to man, it has been a continuous expansion towards infinity. So what is the direction? Evolution is not complete. Physical evolution is over. Now mental evolution starts. And we reach infinity. Again, that universal has come. Towards that, we are growing. If we think we are growing, all right, we will grow to infinity. Then we will be real individuals. But the real thing is that evolution of nature and manifestation of soul. So, only our body, mind, they are changing, not the reality. It is manifesting itself more and more. Therefore, the limited soul can be styled an individual which is continuously expanding toward the infinite individual. Perfect individuality will only be reached when it has reached the infinite. Till then we are changing, we are not individuals. But on this side of the infinite, it is a continuously changing, growing personality. This is the in-between step, Swamiji is explaining. One of the remarkable features of the Advaita system of Vedanta is to harmonize the preceding system. That we told is Swamiji's speciality. In many cases, it helped the philosophy very much. In some cases, it hurt it. That means it becomes a compromise, it hurts it. It becomes only on the way, then it is all right. Our ancient philosophers knew what you call the theory of evolution, that growth is gradual, step by step, and the recognition of this led them to harmonize all the preceding system. Consciousness itself is evolving. And so you feel like that, duality and qualified monotheism and all that, monism. Thus, not one of these preceding ideas was rejected. The fault of the Buddhistic faith was that it had neither the faculty nor the perception of this continual expansive growth. And for this reason, it never even made an attempt to harmonize itself with the pre-existing steps toward the ideal. They were rejected as useless and harmful. Many modern philosophers do like that. But that is the present state, fact of our experience. And when we evolve, then only we understand. When we evolve further, we understand further. So, Buddhi Ved, that is created by Buddhists, that we are no soul at all. Man loses faith in himself. This tendency in religion is most harmful. A man gets a new and better idea, and then he looks back on those who has given up, and forthwith decides that they were mischievous and unnecessary. From there we have come here. He never thinks that however crude they may appear from the present point of view. This is what I was telling the other day. The so-called Advaitists also do like that. They are not real Advaitists. They were very useful to him, that they were necessary for him to reach his present state, and that every one of us has to grow in a similar fashion. This is Swamiji's broad concept of Advaitism, broad concept of Vedanta, as he has learned from Sri Ramakrishna. That they were necessary for him to reach his present state, and that every one of us has to grow in a similar fashion, living first on crude ideas, taking benefit from them. That means the operative part again. Benefit from them means showing something there, how to grow. And then arriving at a higher standard. With the oldest theories, therefore, the Advaita is friendly. Dualism and all system that we find in the great acharyas like Gaudapada, they say we have no quarrel with them. They say we know that the relations are all based upon Advaita only. Dualism and all system that have preceded it are accepted by the Advaita, not in a patronizing way. Not in a patronizing way. You are not correct, but we accept. No, no. You are growing, and you grow into this, our idea. But with the conviction that they are true manifestations of the same truth. That is the difference. Swamiji has said, man does not grow from error to truth, but from lower truth to higher truth. And that they all lead to the same conclusions as the Advaita has reached. So in this he is harmonizing, not patronizing, correctly encouraging. So all those who had some doubt in the mind up till now that the Advaita is destroying will be relieved. That whatever you believe today is only fact of your experience. And you find how to grow. And when you grow, you will find the truth. With blessings and not with cursing should be preserved all these various steps through which humanity has to pass. Therefore, all these dualistic systems have never been rejected or thrown out. Because in Upanishads we find all this. But have been kept intact in the Vedanta. And the dualistic conception of the individual soul limited and complete in itself finds its place in the Vedanta. According to dualism, man dies, so now he is explaining some ideas which will help us to grow. According to dualism, man dies and goes to other worlds and so forth. And these ideas are kept in the Vedanta in their entirety. Or with the recognition of growth in the Advaita system, these theories are given their proper place by admitting that they represent only a partial view of the truth. This is Swamiji's special contribution to this practical Vedanta. This is the practical now. What? Growth. Growth is the practical Vedanta. From the dualistic standpoint, this universe can only be looked upon as a creation of matter or force, can only be looked upon as the play of a certain will, and that will again can only be looked upon as separate from the universe. Will, matter and force, creation. That is how the dualistic theory will think. Thus a man from such a standpoint has to see himself as composed of a dual nature, body and soul. That is why he thinks. So first it was shown that logically not possible, but as an experience this is what we feel. And this soul, though limited, is individually complete in itself. Such a man's ideas of immortality and of the future life would necessarily accord with his idea of soul. These phases have been kept in the Vedanta, and it is therefore necessary for me to present to you a few of the popular ideas of dualism. So the useful ideas about in dualism, Swamiji will present now. That is the broadest conception. That is the practical, most practical conception. According to this theory, we have a body, of course, and behind the body there is what they call a fine body. Shall we go at this? Is this becoming too much? Depends upon how much you have come. Well, the body, of course, and beyond this body, there is a what they call a fine body, Sukshma Shari. Remember, we discuss all these in Vedanta as facts of experience only, not as the ultimate truth. But we experience them. So, as Swamiji says, from low truth to higher truth. So, it's starting now. I think we shall take it up on the next class only. Swamiji has explained that we are real only as universal, not as individual, but we can think of ourselves as growing individuals, so we shall not remain what we are. And from that point of view, what we feel today, what is the method of growth, that Swamiji will discuss in the next class. So, we stop half the paragraph at this, and we shall read this continuity of this paragraph from this point of view. According to this theory, up till now I have seen that these theories are according to the different evolution of experience. So, he takes up a theory by theory that we shall see in the next time. Om Paratatve Sadalino Ramakrishna Samagya Yo Dharma Sthapana Rato Viresham Tam Namamyam Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat Shri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu. Our great Swami Vivekananda has done everything for us. He has thought out, reconciled, seen Sri Ramakrishna, and is describing that to, for our group.